Hi there, I'm Anna Olson, and I'm so glad you've joined me right here on Oh Yum, because it's an exciting moment. We have crossed 400,000 subscribers. So to celebrate, in reading all of the questions you've left on the videos, we've picked some of the top ones and I'm going to answer them for you. In addition to answering some baking questions, I'll also handle some behind the scenes questions as well. So you have to stay with me. Before I get started though, remember, you want to be one of those subscribers, so just click on the button and I'll see you later for some brand new videos. So the very first question is, do I own my own bake shop? And the answer is, at this moment, no. I did own a bake shop in the beautiful Niagara region for a number of years, and I loved connecting with my customers that way. I also have background being a professional pastry chef at a fine dining restaurant, again in Niagara, called Inn on the 20, and I spent over 8 years there. So with just under 2 decades of professional experience, I've had a good mix of plated desserts meant to be served to customers, but also designing desserts that you as a customer are meant to take home and enjoy as a whole. And I feel that's really helped influence my style when it comes to the recipes that I like to share with you. The next question I've been asked is, what is the most difficult dish I've ever made? I see a difficult dish and a complicated dish as two different things. And one of the most technically challenging things I've ever had to make, and you might agree if you've tried making them, French macaron. Simple ingredients, ground almonds, sugar, egg whites, and yet they are virtually just impossible to get consistent and perfect on the first try. When I learned how to make macaron in cooking school, I was told I would have to fail to succeed. So you actually have to go through the process once to sort of feel the macaron through each step, because it's all about the technique. And then you want to get, of course, these beautiful cookies with a satin top to them and what's called the foot at the bottom, that ruffle of sugary goodness that when sandwiched together with a buttercream or ganache is spectacular. It's hard to get a full batch of them perfectly done, but I have some great techniques. You can catch my citrus macaron recipe right here on Oh Yum, or if you want to get a little playful, I have a delicious recipe for some spider macaron, perfect for Halloween time. Here's a fun question. How much butter do I go through in a month? Well, when I'm recipe testing, honestly, I can go through 6 to 10 pounds in a week. In fact, I just picked up 6 pounds yesterday. I always look for a sale. It freezes well, so when I'm recipe testing, if I can't get through my butter inventory in time, and it does take up a fair bit of space in the fridge, I pop it in the freezer. I love baking with unsalted butter. That way, I'm in charge of the salt. Now, here's an interesting question. Do I prefer using Dutch processed cocoa or regular cocoa powder? Now, this is an important distinction because it is not a quality-based choice. The reason I choose to use Dutch processed cocoa in a recipe is because of the treatment it actually goes through, reducing the acidity content. So that results in a cocoa powder that reacts differently with my baking powder, baking soda, but also has a richer color and a deeper but slightly milder taste. So if I call for Dutch processed cocoa powder in a recipe, it's for a specific reason. I need it to react with all the other ingredients in a very specific way. Okay, this is a question I get asked on a regular basis. Please, can you tell me about those drawers that I have in my kitchen? And what was the inspiration? And the follow-up part to that question, how do I keep ants out of the sugar drawer? So, the inspiration for the drawers on the set of bake is quite simple. In my bakery, and in most bakeries, you'll find that sugar, flour, and other large quantity ingredients are stored in rolling bins that are kept under the wooden work table we work at. They're central, everybody can access them, and we love that sense of a bakery feel and the ease of accessing ingredients. Being on camera, my hands are full, so juggling canisters back and forth just didn't make a lot of sense. But you'll notice, and you have because you're asking about the ants, that when I open the drawer, the sugar is exposed right there. Well, a little inside tip, what you don't see is when we cut cameras and it's the end of the day and we get to go home, there are lids that go on top of each bin, so that protects the sugar from any ants. But honestly, there are no ants on our set. I love this question. Do I treasure old kitchen utensils? And if so, do I have any family collectibles, anything special? And the answer is, oh, yes. And considering that my grandmother was my inspiration to be a pastry chef, because of her pure love of baking, those tools that she used and that were special to her mean so much to me. So I have a number of pieces, including a beautiful set of her ceramic mixing bowls. I actually have her old stand mixer from the 1940s. Believe it or not, it still works. I would only ever dare whipped cream or a meringue in there, but it is a beautiful piece. I also have a lovely collection of her presentation plates and cups, all depression glass from that era, beautiful green and pink colors. So, I mean, those things mean a lot to me. Now, here's a question with an interesting story as an answer. What is my first food memory from when I was a kid? Well, there are a lot of food memories all jumbled in there, but I do have an interesting memory and documentation of the very first recipe I ever wrote. And I remember the experience because our neighbor, Mrs. Hubbard, was babysitting me and I was 5 years old and I was quite impressed by her banana salad. So I asked for the recipe. And being a retired school teacher, she dictated the recipe and had me write it out. And so here is a photo of the original recipe. My mom saved it all of these years for banana salad. The good news is my spelling has improved tremendously. The sad news is my handwriting has not. Thank goodness for computers. The next question is, what was my first dish as a professional pastry chef? And how did I deal with the criticism? I can actually remember the recipe for the very first dish I had to make as my job as pastry chef, because it was the restaurant's signature dish, double espresso chocolate torte. So you start with 3 kilos of dark chocolate, you melt that with 2 liters of whipping cream, 2 pounds of butter, you whisk in 1 kilo of sugar and 36 eggs. Now, admittedly, that's a recipe that makes 6 full-size 10-inch torts that cuts into 16 pieces. But I remember being so nervous about getting it right and consistent for what guests who had come in over years would expect of it. I also loved that it was a flourless recipe before we really knew fully about celiac and gluten-free recipes. This fulfilled that wish. And let me tell you, that was a decadent dessert. It was popular, so I'll be honest, I felt fortunate that I didn't have to face negative criticism too often. But I take such critiques to heart. I listen to your opinions and thoughts. And my challenge is always to make what I make and the recipes that give you the power to make things for those you love just that much better. Now, here's a question I bet a lot of cooking show hosts get asked. What happens to all the food at the end of the taping day? Well, the honest truth is the first people who get to pull out their forks and dive in are the crew, because they've been looking at that delicious food up close and on video monitors for 12 hours straight. Now, after everyone has had their fill, any desserts that are intact, and we make sure, of course, are food safe, can get packed up and either sent home with friends and family, or I can send any baked goods or dishes over to our local shelter. And also there's a member of my food team who does work with our local hospice, and she would pack up goodies at the end of the shoot and take them to be enjoyed by volunteers and families alike. I appreciate your curiosity in asking me how long it takes to make a recipe video, because what you see unfold in 6 minutes, 9 minutes, 12 minutes actually takes hours. When I have a day of recipe taping scheduled, I plan about 3 recipes, and it's a good 8, even up to 12 hour shoot day, depending how involved the recipe is. I do the recipe multiple times. That way the cameras can shift their angles and perspectives, because the whole point when you put all these angles and perspectives together is to really give you as much information as possible, because food is about all of the senses. Sight, sound, touch, smell, and taste, of course. But when you're watching a video on Oh Yum, all you have is sight and sound. So we put as much dimension into those 2 senses to replace the other 3. I appreciate tackling technical baking questions. So when you ask me how to whip cream properly so that it doesn't turn liquidy, split on you, or when you're frosting a cake, it doesn't run off the sides, well, I've got an answer for you. When it comes to whipping cream, if you're in a humid climate, it can be more at risk of splitting quickly, going from liquid cream to all of a sudden being overwhipped and actually curdling. So my tip there is to put your bowl that you plan on whipping the cream in the fridge and make sure that cream is very, very cold before you whip it. That helps the transition. When it comes to whipping cream, to get the appropriate pillowy peaks, what you want to do is actually whip the cream on one speed less than high. It doesn't compromise the volume in your cream, but it does spread out that time of whipping from liquid to a soft peak and a stiffer peak as you go along. And my final tip, and this is a valuable one, to stabilize your whipped cream so that you can use it to frost a cake and have it stay in place, even when you cut through it, is for every one fluid cup of whipping cream, so 250 ml, add 1 tablespoon or 15 ml of instant skim milk powder. You can add it at any point in the whipping process, but the protein from the skim milk powder stabilizes the whipped cream, so then it holds every swirl, swish, and dollop you give it. Substitutions are a hot topic, so I love getting asked what you can use in place of milk and cream, especially if you're lactose intolerant. Now, in place of milk, there are different dairy-free options out there. For baking, if you can have nuts, I prefer almond milk as a milk alternative in recipes. It's got the fat content, it's got the richness, natural sweetness and flavor that suits baking. If that's not an option, then I find soy milk works very well. What I try and steer clear of is rice milk because it's just a little too thin for baking. And on the cream side of things, you can replace cream that calls for fluid or even lightly whipped cream by using coconut cream. So what you want to do is take a tin of coconut milk, don't shake it, and you want to put it in the fridge overnight. Then when you open the tin, again, don't shake it, but you can spoon off the fat or the coconut cream that has floated to the top. And just like whipping cream, you pull your whisk through it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it doubles in volume. And then it's ready to use and it will hold its volume in your favorite recipes. As a quick alternative, just a last point, for butter, coconut oil is really the best option because it's a vegetable-based fat that holds its shape at room temperature. So it works wonderfully in cookies, cakes, and all sorts of preparations. I can really tell you're paying attention to my baking videos by this question. You've noticed that in some cases, I just grease my pan, some cases I grease and flour my pan, some cases I don't even grease the pan at all. So why do I have these different options? And really, it's the batter that tells me what to do. So a traditional cake batter that is rather runny and thin, because of its moisture, is at risk of sticking to the sides of the pan. So that's why I grease and then flour the pan. I always line the bottom with parchment paper so that way it tips out all in one piece. Some simple loaves like a banana bread or my classic zucchini and orange loaf. Well, a basic loaf cake like that, you can just grease the pan and know that you can tip it out easily, but I always let it cool for about 20 minutes before I try and tip it out of the pan. But the special cakes like angel food cakes, chiffon cakes, and sponge cakes that I actually want to climb up the sides of the pan and stick, well, those are the pans that I don't grease at all. That way, I get the fullest volume and the most level cake. Another common substitution question I get is about egg replacements. So if you can't consume eggs for allergy or vegan reasons, there are some great options. So for simpler homey preparations, like a drop cookie, say an oatmeal cookie, a muffin, or a loaf cake, to replace every one egg, you want to take 3 tablespoons of cool water and stir in 2.5 teaspoons of ground flaxseed. Or you can take a tablespoon of whole flaxseeds and grind them yourself. You stir those together and until they get kind of sticky, and it's the protein that is actually coming out of the flaxseeds that will help bind your dish together and replace that egg. Now, if I'm making something more delicate, like a traditional cake, or I have even made butterless, eggless egg tarts, and that's a case where I use silken tofu. And because a large egg, the standard size called for in most baking recipes, is 2 ounces or 60 grams, you simply replace one egg with 60 grams of soft tofu, and that sets your dairy-free, egg-free lemon squares easily. Now, this is truly a popular question. How do I substitute wheat flour for gluten-free flour in my baking? And I wish it was so simple as a one-to-one substitution, but really gluten, the protein that's in flour that bonds baked goods together, and which, of course, if you're gluten-free, you can't have, needs to be replaced by a combination of ingredients. Now, typically, I don't use pre-mixed gluten-free flour blends because I don't know where you are, what you have access to, and different brands are very different. So I typically rely on making my own combination, and the general rule that I start with, and it can really vary depending on the recipe, the simplest substitution and a really good starting point is for every 1 cup of all-purpose flour, use 2/3 of a cup of brown rice flour and 1/3 of a cup of tapioca starch. The starch really helps replace the protein that's bonding your baked goods together. And it's a really good place to start for cookies, muffins, simple loaves, and it's even the ratio I use when I make my flourless pie crust. I'm really glad you're asking practical questions, like the simple question about freezing your baked goods. When is the best time to freeze them? Before baking, after baking? How long do I freeze them? How do I treat them when they come out of the freezer? Well, when it comes to things made with yeast doughs, say if you're making puff pastry or a croissant dough, you can freeze yeast doughs unbaked. If you're filling it like a croissant, I would fill it beforehand and then freeze it. And to freeze it, what I do is lay everything out on a baking sheet. Then once frozen, I package them up because then they will stick together. Things like cookies and squares can freeze well, but as a general rule, the less sugar that is in the recipe, the more effectively it'll freeze because sugar, once frozen and then thawed, wants to liquefy. So sometimes you might find things like butter tart bars might be a bit sticky coming out of the freezer. And my general freezing tip is 3 months is about my maximum because after that point, your baked goods love to absorb odors in the freezer and also can get a little frost and they just won't taste quite as delicious when you first made them. Now here's a short question that's a big question and warrants a good answer. Any tips for beginners? Now if you're just jumping into baking for the first time, I invite you to first read the recipe start to finish. Make sure you have the appropriate tools that are called for. And so simple recipes like cookies and muffins, often all you need is a bowl and a spoon or maybe a whisk and away you go. But you do want to read the recipe start to finish to make sure you've devoted enough time for it. Then as you improve and get excited about baking and you want to spend every spare minute of your time in the kitchen creating, what you want to do is remember, just like going to cooking school, practice, practice, practice. When it comes to baking, repetition is the key. You know, I've been making the same chocolate chip cookie recipe or some version of for almost all of my life. And that's the one you're seeing here on Oh Yum. But with every time I make it, there's always that little something. I analyze what I'm doing, how can I make it better? And I feel like I've hit that perfect point. So as you create and develop your own baking repertoire by using my recipes, others, you really shape your identity. Remember, it takes practice. It does take a little patience. The hardest thing is waiting for things to cool out of the oven. And always there's a lesson. If something doesn't go right, guaranteed it's delicious. So a little dusting of icing sugar will fix any mistake. And here's a great question that comes from Peru. Someone who's been baking for 8 months and has obviously got the baking bug, wants to learn more, teach themselves more, and wants to know what to do. Well, what I can offer is quite simply read, watch, cook, bake, anything and everything you can. And if you are thinking that you actually want to approach baking as a professional career, what I would invite you to do is what we call in the industry, quite simply, it's called a stage. And that means that you go to a bakery or a restaurant where you admire the desserts and you offer your services. It can be for as little as a few hours in a day, or it could actually be for a number of weeks. And it allows you to actually be in the kitchen. Sadly, it's not paid, which is why even a few hours is okay. But it allows you to get the experience of working in a professional bakery or kitchen to see if that style of cooking suits what you do at home, because it's a big difference from making 2 dozen chocolate chip cookies at home to having to make 400 dozen in a retail environment with a different set of tools. And it can really hook you. I know I loved the adrenaline of the restaurant and bakery business. And I still get that same energy when I'm able to speak to you preparing my recipes and share them with you here on OYUM. Well, thank you for spending some time with me. I'm so thrilled we had this opportunity to chat so I could answer your questions. So if you want to hear answers to more of your questions, please like this video and do include your questions. I'd love to be back and hear more, because I know then what to create in terms of new recipes and new content by the questions you ask. So please remember to subscribe right here on OYUM, and I've got tons of new content coming your way.